Sherry Peel Jackson. She is an ex-IRS agent, CPA, fraud examiner. She was working for the IRS. She was on the fast track to success there. She was doing very well, had received numerous awards for all of the work she did, and she realized that there is no law and that the biggest fraud was the IRS.
I tried to be the best at whatever I did, so when I got to the IRS, I hit the ground running. My first year in 1988, I got a fraud award. It's a big shaped in Georgia award for fraud. But I got numerous awards, and my biggest one is from the IRS commissioner himself back in 1995. It was Fred T. Goldberg. One of the things that I wanted to tip you off on as far as what the IRS does before I get into the story, I don't know what they're doing now, but they had what's called a Market Segment Specialization Program, or MSSP. They would take different market segments, like ministers, and try to figure out how much money you were underreporting. Let's take beauticians, for example. I'm going to audit her beauty shop. She owns the shop and she has some people working there. Based on the assumption that the IRS has that people don't report all of their money, but they like to put all their expenses on there. So granted, all her expenses are on the tax return, and I figure out how many bottles of this and that she bought, I can calculate a dollar figure. So I'll tell Sophia, after it's all over and we're buddy-buddy, I just shock her and I say, well, guess what? It looks like, based on my calculations, that you really brought in $80,000, but you have $50,000 on the tax return. So here, you have to owe the IRS back $30,000. What would she do? She was shocked. She would sign off on it. I only had two cases in 7.5 years where somebody actually bucked at me. People are so afraid. The government and the media have gotten you guys so afraid of the IRS that you don't even buck them. Now, mind you, she might have left some money off. Maybe there was several times where she just didn't report the cash. And maybe that's why. Maybe she has no idea how much she, quote, unquote, underreported. Maybe that was it. But they always acquiesce. They got one, anybody own a laundromat? They have one that will calculate, based on your water bill, how many loads were washed at your laundromat. And the point to all of this is what they do to people, and people just acquiesce to it. When I quit the IRS in 1995, and after maybe a year of being Jim Cleaver and realizing that that was just not me, I hung my shingle, which in accounting terms or business terms is you start your own business. Now, you know that picture of Uncle Sam, the one that says Uncle Sam wants you? I used that same picture, and I had it really big, and I says, Uncle Sam wants your money. But I'm a former IRS agent. I'm going to show you how to get it back. You know, the people came running. And then these people start coming to me saying, I keep hearing that we're not supposed to pay tax. Or I keep hearing that the tax law is a fraud. And like I said, I was raised differently. I never would look at that person and say, you're a cuckoo. I wouldn't even think it. It was like, okay, you know, in this back burner back here, I would think to myself, okay, there's some people out there that actually think that the income tax doesn't apply to us, or it's a fraud, or it's being misapplied. But I didn't do anything about it because, remember, I'm rolling along with my little businesses and whatnot. So one night in early June, one of my pastor clients called. It was night. It was about 9 o'clock at night. And she said, you know what? I think it was maybe a Wednesday night after her Wednesday night service. She said, I've got this parishioner that just keeps bugging me about this income tax. She's talking about that we're not liable for the income tax, and she wants to talk to you. Can I give this lady your telephone number? And I said, okay. So maybe about 10 minutes later, this lady called me. She said, I have a question for you. Are we supposed to pay income tax or not? And I said, okay. Do you want the cuffed answer or do you want the real answer? She said, I want the real answer. I said, well, I really don't know. You know, even though I'm a former IRS agent, I haven't done the research, but I hear that there's a credible body of evidence out there that says that we don't owe income tax. I was okay. I mean, I took the information. I was sitting there listening like, okay, okay, okay. And, you know, I said, okay, this lady had a lot of information. I don't know where she got it from. So a few weeks later, she called me again and she said, Miss Jackson, remember that information I told you on the phone? It's in the USA Today. Pull it up on the internet. Okay, so I got the USA Today. It was July 7th, 2000. And it says, Dear We the People, most citizens are not required to file an income tax return. The 16th Amendment to the Constitution is a fraud. And if you file, you waive your Fifth Amendment rights. I said, okay, that's another stuff she was saying. Now, this was a lot of reading. But I kept reading because I was very interested, you know, being a CPA and into fraud and all that. I wanted to see what was going on. So here in the third column, it says no one has been able to collect the $50,000 reward offered by Bill Conklin.
to anyone that can identify the section of the Internal Revenue Code that makes a typical worker liable for the income tax. I'm serious about winning this $50,000. Okay, so it's at my desk. Basically, I just shoved everything off my desk and got the codes out, the regulations out, the tax guide. I got on the internet to look at the Cornell University site, all these different things, and I started researching. And 2 weeks later, I said to myself, oh my goodness, we have a problem here. It doesn't look like I'm going to win this money. And I was sitting there at my desk thinking, this thing is a fraud. 2 weeks it took me to sit there and realize that. I didn't just look at the positive. I looked at the negative. I looked at the IRS site. All these things are going on. This thing is a fraud. Being a CPA and a former IRS agent, I sat there at the desk, you know, I was by myself, and all these thoughts started going through my head. The first thought was, now I finally open up the codes and regulations. Because see, at the IRS, they trained us with these little guides. We didn't use the codes and regulations. We would get one of these, and you would have to read it, understand it, and pass this little test. And all these little guides that I got, I read them, and I made A's on all my tests. And I thought, and I guess the rest of the agents in training thought, that the information that was in here was the same that was in those thick codes and regulations. But it's not necessarily the same. The things that are in these training manuals are not necessarily the same things in the codes and regulations. I learned that in my studying. And the time that I was doing the research, I also learned about the pocket commission. Now, I'm going to let this go around the room, but y'all got to give it back. This is the outside that I purchased of the pocket commission that I had. And before I left, I had the sense of mind to make a copy. This is the little badge I used to flip out at people and say, give me your books and records. Give me your bank statements. Give me all your credit cards, you know. And, you know, people, okay, here. You know, even the counties, I go to the county, do it. I go just about anywhere and flip this little thing out and get whatever I want. You know, there's a lot of power nuts out there doing that, guys. Y'all know it. Half of you already know about it. There's an enforcement pocket commission, and there's a non-enforcement pocket commission. And I started looking back at this thing. It has SER, Southeast Region. First of all, I'll read it. It has my picture up here, and it says, Sherry Jackson, whose signature and picture appear above, is duly commissioned as Internal Revenue Agent and has authority to perform all duties conferred upon such officers under all laws and regulations administered by the Internal Revenue Service, including the authority to investigate and require and receive information as to all matters relating to such laws and regulations. And it has SER and some other numbers and an A. And based on this Internal Revenue Manual, A means administrative. So I'm an administrative clerk out there on the front lines, and I'm an administrative clerk with a non-enforcement pocket commission. Okay, so I'm starting to get angry here. Starting to think about all that. I had to take bribes and get little tape recorders taped to my body and the little microphones on me and go in and take bribes from people. But, you know, thinking about stuff like that, you know, what they got me out here, and I'm thinking I really have authority. And this is administrative. Non-enforcement pocket commission. That was one of the other things I thought about. And then I thought about, and I found out, this is another issue, a levy versus a notice of levy. This is something that I didn't deal with a lot because I was an agent, and I just assessed the tax. I wasn't a tax collector. I just assessed it. So this is a notice of levy, and someone said, hey, this is a notice of levy. This is what the banks get, or your job, or whatever. They said, look at the back of it. So I'm looking at the back of this notice of levy, and it says, Section 6331, levy and distraint. And then it says B and C. And I'm thinking, it starts off with B? What happened to A? So I looked up A. And here's A. And it says, levy may be made upon the accrued salary or wages of any officer, employee, or elected official of the United States, the District of Columbia, or any agency or instrumentality of the United States or the District of Columbia, by serving a notice of levy. I'm thinking, but that's not most people. That's not the person that works at AT&T or Bell South or Coca-Cola. That's not most people. Aren't people noticing that the A isn't on here? Aren't they curious about it? Why are they doing this? All this is going through my head during this period of time, then I'm realizing that there's a rat in the camp. That's what I call it. But this is the straw that broke the camel's back. The Federal Reserve is not federal. How many of you did not know before today that the Federal Reserve isn't federal? If you did not, don't be shy. If you didn't know before today that the Federal Reserve isn't federal, raise your hand. Most people don't know that. 9 out of 10 people that I asked off the street don't understand that the Federal Reserve is a non-auditable private banking cartel. They are collecting